go back to Philippians. But you will remember, and I'll read it out loud while you're turning to Acts. Paul said, "Even as it is right for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, ye all are partakers of my grace." And so Paul could, as I said, Paul could have gone anywhere with this. He could have said, you know, you pray, or because, you know, we're believing God together. That's where most of us would go with the things that he'd said up through verse 1 all the way to verse 7. But all of a sudden, he brings up this thing of imprisonment. And in Acts 16, we read let's go ahead and reread verse 22, starting right there. "And the multitude rose up together against them. The magistrate tore off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison, made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed." That's pretty cool. I mean, we're not just talking about the earthquake knocking the doors open. We're talking about all of the, you know, their legs were in stocks, you know, everybody in chains, everything falls off. It's a miracle, see? And that's the approach that most people take. They only see the miracle side of it. All right, but let's keep reading. verse 27, "And the keepers of the prison, awakening out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled." And again, this is because he knew that if they got away, he would be blamed and he would be killed for this, okay? And so so he took out his sword and was just going to take his own life at that moment. "But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, 'Do thyself no harm, for we are all here.' Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, 'Sirs, what must I do to be saved?' And they said, 'Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house.' And they spoke unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all of his immediately. And when he had brought them into his house, he set food before them and rejoiced, believing in God with all of his house." Let's finish this off. "And when it was day, the magistrate sent the sergeant, saying, 'Let those men go.' And the keeper of the prison told the saying to Paul. The magistrate told this saying to Paul, 'The magistrates have sent to let you go. Now therefore depart and go in peace.' And Paul said unto them, 'They have beaten us openly, uncondemned, being Romans, and have cast us into prison, and now do they thrust us out privately? Nay, verily.'" And that's always a tough deal when you say "nay, verily." "Nay, verily, but let them come themselves and fetch us out." So they're saying, "We're going to stay in prison unless they come get us out." "And the sergeants told these words unto the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that they were Romans. And they came and besought them and brought them out and desired them to depart out of the city. And they went out of the prison and entered into the house of Lydia. And when they had seen the brethren, they comforted them and departed." All right. Let me, since we are not moving real fast out of one verse, let's go back to Philippians. And let me just read a little bit here so that we can see and cover a little more ground. So Paul was imprisoned. He was imprisoned because of the gospel. And this whole incident happened in the book of Acts. And I wrote, the result of that was that a gathering of believers called the church at Philippi formed as a result of that visit. The primary things that happened was Paul went to a prayer meeting. He met Lydia. On his way to one of the prayer meetings, he cast out a demon. The majority of the story is about him being in prison. And the subject that he brings up in verse 7 is not casting out a demon. It's not a miracle of getting out of prison. It is directly related to his imprisonment and his defense of the gospel being produced in such a manner that they all had become partakers of his grace. Okay? All right, so the result of that was that this church was formed. But Paul's emphasis upon them becoming partakers of his grace was not premised upon his excellent presentation of the true message to them, but what he went through concerning bonds and imprisonment and that of defending the gospel rather than defending himself in an effort to be free, become free from prison. In other words, he doesn't attribute this church being raised up as the result of great preaching. And in fact, really, it doesn't say that he preached at the prayer meeting. It doesn't say that he preached in the prison. It doesn't say that he preached before that in the sense of preaching a great message and they're all of a sudden affected and go, oh my God, this great thing of Christ and him crucified, it's wonderful. That's not what he said. He said that the results that took place in Philippian are directly related to his bonds, to his imprisonment, and the dynamic that took place in Paul in that process. So the apostle believed that life would come out only out of death. And notice I said only out of death, that everywhere that he went, he wanted an increase of Christ. And Mike and I were talking about that at halftime, and he mentioned he'd heard somebody share on that of he must increase and we must decrease, and they likened it to a standard shift car where you have a clutch, and if you sit there and you don't depress the clutch, but you rev up the engine, you put it on the gas, it goes, and you can blow the engine. But on the other hand, if you depress the clutch, it begins to release the engine to take over and to carry it for you. Well, that's a simplified version. I mean, the true decrease, folks, is the cross. I mean, it is. I mean, Paul didn't say, well, I'm depressed. Sorry, I couldn't resist. He said, I'm crucified. He didn't say, I'm slowly getting out of the way. Now there's, you know, remember, there's verse 1, there's at Philippi and in Christ, right? And in Christ, you're not slowly getting out of the way. You're crucified. Can I get amen? At Philippi, you're probably slowly getting out of the way. I mean, you should, you know, if the more you embrace the reality of you in Christ. Remember, this is verse 1 of Philippians here. The more you embrace the reality of in Christ, the more that you're just dead. You reckon yourself dead. But the less you embrace that, the more you live at Philippi or wherever you're living. Philippi sounds a lot better than Dentai. yeah, Dentonians. This journey to cross the Jordan, which represents crucifixion with Christ, not just by the river, but by the opening of the river and the taking of the stones of from the wilderness side, representing them and all their days, not just in the wilderness, but in Egypt, and taking 12 stones representing 12 tribes and walking down into the middle of the Jordan where it stopped on either side and it was flooding its banks, and putting those 12 stones in there, and then taking 12 stones other than those that were already in death out of the Jordan, out of the riverbed, and carrying them out and going onto the resurrection side and setting them up as a pillar so that it would constantly be a reminder of the reality of what took place. We went into death and we didn't come out. Stones that had that were in death came out. And that's Christ in his body. 12 tribes. And so, let's see, where was I? Paul felt as if the affection, here we go, Paul felt as if the affection that worked within him and the willingness to embrace contrary circumstances, meaning the willingness to go into prison, okay, what does that mean? Basically, what I'm saying is that Paul understood that life comes only out of death. That you can pray over a seed, you can beg a seed, you can preach to a seed, you can draw charts to the seed about what a tree with fruit looks like. You can do all of that stuff, and if you don't put it into death, it will not bring forth life, because life only comes out of death. Only. And Paul, at this point, believed that, and he was willing to embrace this death, as it were, this prison sentence, this rejection, this decrease of reputation. Come on, you know. It's not really a good thing to have a record with the police and get pulled over, and they said, "Can I see your driver's license?" And then they say, "Well, you know, in my case, they say, well, I see you got two felonies. In Texas, 3 strikes and you're out, life in prison. One more, life, you know." It's not something you go, "Hey, well, when you check that out on my driver's license, you're gonna find that I got 2 felonies," as if that's a badge of honor or something. The only place that's a badge of honor is when you're in prison. Yeah. You know. So it doesn't lend itself to a good reputation. Okay? Every time Paul went into prison, believe it or not, he had to die to a certain reputation. And let's just say in his mind, maybe this all wasn't fully clear yet. And every time he got thrown into prison, every time he got beaten with stripes, every time, you know, and here he is in a Roman center being beaten with stripes. So this goes all the way to Rome, that his reputation is decreasing. And pretty soon, and you can read in Corinthians his little manifesto on all the stuff he's been through, you know, how many times in the deep I've received, you know, stripes, I forget how many times, 3 times I think it was, and, you know, what? Shipwrecked. Yes. I can't believe I forgot that one. Okay, it's over with. It was pretty amazing there for a minute, but it's really shipwrecked, ain't that big a deal. All of these things that were happening to him because he was going after God with all of his heart, because he was trying to reach people, all of these things were chipping away at his reputation, chipping away at his ministry, chipping away at his integrity, chipping away at the things that the world holds as important until he'd been through so many, he finally realized several things. One is, if anyone's ever going to receive me, can you hear Paul? It's going to have to be Christ. But see, he got that strong, didn't he? I mean, he got that strong. We say, well, he got that because he had such a deep revelation of Christ. Glad somebody got what I'm talking about. Because that's, we go, he saw so much, he goes, it's only about Jesus. Jesus is the only thing that's going to make any difference. Jesus, you know, and we go, wow, you know, what a great preacher. No, what a great reject. What a great man who has suffered, who has been defamed, all of these things, till he finally gets to a place that it's absolutely, you know, it's like your reputation is a pile of garbage over there, and you're going, there is absolutely no reason to defend that mess. Okay, you know, there's poop mixed in and everything else, you know, you go, you know, let's just stick with Jesus. Let's just glorify Jesus, you know, okay. But the other part of that is he embraces the death. He embraces the prison. He embraces the suffering. Because he knows that if you suffer, you reign. He knows that if you lose, you gain. He knows that if you die, then resurrection comes. He knows the process. And he's saying, this is my door to you, Philippians. This is going to be my door. This will be the way that I will reach the city of Philippi. Because, folks, the prayer meeting, he didn't start. And the scriptures only declare he won one person out of that prayer meeting. Who was it? Lydia. Oh, Lydia. Anyway, sorry, little Marx Brothers thing kicking in there. Oh, Lydia. But he only won one other person that we have a record of too, the jailer. He won the guy who had made him captive. He released him from his captivity. Now, I don't remember if I wrote it recently. I was just meditating on it or said it. But, you know, just, you know, it's real recent on my mind, this reality that if Paul and Silas, while they're in prison, and the doors come open and the chains come off, if they have a seek to save mentality, meaning I will save myself. Jesus said this, if you seek to save, you're going to lose. But if you lose, you'll gain. Jesus said that. And if you have a seek to save mentality, then you go, this is the Lord. You embrace what happens as a miracle from God for your release, because you don't understand the cross. You don't understand the nature of the Lamb. You don't understand the way of God. You don't understand how he produced all things. Everything came out of a death, out of a cross. Everything. It didn't come out of a big miracle. He did miracles. He was doing miracles. He constantly did all these miracles until finally one day this ragtag bunch of 12 disciples is following him, and he turns and he says, this is it. The Passover's coming. Except a corn of wheat fall on the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it dies, it brings forth much fruit. Can you hear? I mean, if I was there, if I was one of the 12, I'd go, what are you saying? See, we just read that and go, amen, hallelujah. I go, what are you saying? Are you saying you haven't brought forth any fruit yet? What about that blind man? What about feeding them 5,000? What about them? I sound like a preacher, TV. What about that? And my Lord said, you know. People pay money to see that. Anyway. If Paul and Silas misread, and I mean misread, a miracle is a good way to misread God. Because God did it, God allowed it, the earthquake happened, every chain fell off of every prisoner, And Paul didn't read it as, this is God saving me. Paul, listen to this. Paul read it as an opportunity to stay in prison, in death, with the result that it would affect someone else. You believe that?
Yes.
Good for you. Because I do, and I believe it's right. So here's the scenario. There's the jailer. If Paul and Silas are gone when he gets in there, Paul says, God saved us. We're saved. You die. Right? He either kills himself or the Romans kill him because it's a Roman city. Okay? So if I live, then you die. But if I die, if you understand what I'm saying, stay in death, then you live. Does that make sense? It's exactly what happened. That's the exchange that happened. So the guy that was this close to death now has found life, not only for him, but his whole family, and that has turned. And we don't have the story, folks. We don't have it all written out. I love that. We don't have it all written out. And then the jailer and his wife, you know, the jailer went to Thomas down the street, and his wife, he hooked up with Lydia, and they started really evangelizing. And then the children, because they found the Lord, they went, but something happened. Because there was a church there at Philippi after that. How in the world? If that had been us in that prison, we would have started a church. We'd have stayed right there, and we'd have been the first church of the earthquake chains off ministry. Yeah, we would have capitalized, gained. We would have used the miracle, which didn't release anybody because they didn't go, and built a huge ministry about it. That's exactly what most people do. If God does something in their life, especially something big, they start a ministry around it. Okay? You don't hear any of that. You don't even hear how this church came about. But we know one thing. Ye all are partakers of my grace. Every one of them, the saints, to the saints at Philippi, in Christ at Philippi. You all are partakers of the fact that I went into death. And you're the fruit of it. You're the fruit of it. You're the manifestation that this reality works in God. All right. Let's see. Did I finish? I'll just read this last sentence here, and then we'll go to verse 8 if we have time. Paul felt as if the affection that worked within him and the willingness to embrace contrary circumstances in a right spirit for their sake were actually the source out of which they were able to partake of what Paul had by the Lord. Did you catch it? Because in the same sentence, in not just the same sentences, just before he mentions them becoming partakers, he mentions his imprisonment. He didn't mention a great sermon. You remember that great sermon I preached in Philippi? Are you following? All right. So we believe we're going to change the world. I'm going to get in the Word, and I'm going to get the best sermons. I'm going to preach so good that people are going to come flocking into the kingdom of God. Okay? Paul didn't believe that at all. He didn't believe that was a method. He believed you had to preach because he said, how should they hear without a preacher? He said that. He believed that. But he didn't believe that preaching was the source out of which life sprang. He believed that the cross was. He believed that death was. He believed that you don't have a resurrection without death. You don't have life except it come through means of death. And he was put in this situation, and he's sitting there now, and he knows exactly what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing. He knows exactly what he's doing. So the chains fall off? Uh-uh. So the sergeants come from the magistrates? Uh-uh. We are looking for every opportunity to get out of something. This is the Lord. Yeah, it's the Lord. You know? And he was presented with two in a row. He didn't take it. Okay, what did we talk about in Hebrews? In Hebrews 11, that it says, there are those, and others? Others. Paul was one of those others who would not receive deliverance that they might have a greater resurrection. You could go down in a little death. Okay, little death. Okay, I'm ready to come up. You know what I mean? It's like a farmer, you know, and you put a seed in there, and, you know, 3 days later, okay, I'm ready to come up. And you come over there, and it's got a little bit of life coming out, and you dig it out and go, look, life, you know. And another farmer comes up and goes, how many acres do you own? Oh, 10,000 acres. And you're happy with that. You know, you're happy with that little thing you got there? It's life! It's alive! Anyway, sorry.
Well, I might want to point out that if you dig up a seed after it's sprouted, before it's, you know, rooted in and stuff, it's going to die. So if you dig it up, it's not rooted in, it's going to die. And in fact, when you do transplant plants, you really have to be careful with the roots and stuff anyway.
Right.
But yeah, if you pull it back out of the ground, that little seed that's sprouted with a little bit of life isn't going to last.
Well, and really the whole thought behind that too is just is allowing a death and being happy with a little spurt of life. Okay, are y'all following that? That's what we're talking about here. We're going, now I see life. I've got a little bit of life here. And going, well, that's enough. And Paul didn't, you know, think about this. I mean, there's actually three ways that Paul could have got out. From the moment that they got ready to beat Paul, the moment, what could he have said? I'm a Roman citizen. And what would that have resulted in? They'd have got all scared and everything. But Paul doesn't want to motivate that. Number one, he doesn't want to use things that are not the Lord. He wants to go by way of death. He wants to go by way of the cross. He believes in this reality. Okay? And so he's dedicated to that. Number two, he's not trying to get out of the situation. He believes that this is an opportunity. You could say it another way. He believes that all things can actually work together. You know, I mean, can you hear Silas turn to Paul in the deepest prison and say, brother, I believe something good's going to come out of this. Yes.
Said that we would think that it would be a victorious thing in the Lord, and yeah, Paul could have gone on and preached and rose up a great ministry, but it would literally have been at the expense of someone else's life.
Well, that was my point. That's exactly right. If he had gone, you know, and you know, don't you know Paul thought this, and if Paul didn't, we do, that he's sitting there going, okay, I need to get out of this prison, even if this jailer dies, because I've got a big ministry ahead of me. I've got a destiny. Yeah. I love Paul Bilheimer's book, Destined for the cross. You know, one of my things that I do is I buy used books, old books that preach Christ when I find them, you know. And Paul Bilheimer wrote two books. Well, he wrote many books, but his main two were, one of them is Destined for the Cross and the other one's Destined for the Throne. Okay, I have Destined for the Cross. In my 15 years of going through thrift stores and bookstores and buying up old stuff, because I pass them out and stuff like that, I've found tons of Destined for the Throne. I've never found one Destined for the Cross. I wonder why. There are probably several reasons. One is they didn't sell as many. The other one is, if anybody read it and really got what it had, they don't want to give it away. They're going, I want to hold on to this. This has eternal value to my life. All right. Let me make sure I because those thoughts have been running through my mind. I thought I wrote them down or something. But so it's just real important that we comprehend all of this. All of this is not just explained by John 12:24, which says, except a corn of wheat fall in the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. It's explained by a myriad of scriptures that say it any number of ways. For example, Jesus said John 12:24, but Jesus also said, if you seek to save, you will lose. But if you lose for my sake and the gospel, you will gain. Okay? Do you see? It's the same pattern. And it's important that we start to see this pattern, because that's where we're heading in a major, major way. Did I see a hand? Yes.
It's the hidden wisdom. People don't get it. It's the cross wisdom.
Yeah, it is cross wisdom. It's called the hidden wisdom, but it is cross wisdom. And I wonder, I know we have a lot of courses, but I would love to teach 1 Corinthians next time or pretty soon. Love to do it, because there are so many scriptures in that book, chapters that don't say the cross, it doesn't say Christ crucified, and it's just full of Christ and Him crucified. It's just incredibly full. It's like a honeycomb just running over. Greg?
Because everything you're saying here, I heard another guy say the exact opposite. He literally said the reason why Paul stayed in jail was because he did not have resources. We'd have to understand the scriptures that we do today. And so therefore, because he had fear and intimidation, he couldn't break the mental chains. I'm going, what?
Paul couldn't break the mental chains. And by then, he was already being used to evangelize. He's a little dingbat that God's using. Yeah. Well, you got to understand that it makes absolute perfect sense to seek to save your own life. Folks, the survival instinct is one of the strongest instincts in man. And I will tell you, absolutely, positively, when it comes down to the crux of the matter, when it comes to the crunch, only a revelation of Christ and Him crucified will break that powerful sense of self-survival. Only. And you can be assured, and you can find this in little ways, and you can be assured that when you get into even little circumstances after you claim to believe this, that you will find yourself drifting back towards saying things. Remember this, Paul said the defense and confirmation of the gospel, saying things that defend you so that you'll be seen in a better light instead of defending the gospel, you know, well, well, we preach the cross. Well, what we mean by that is, you know, it's like, let's water this thing down. But I'm telling you, Paul didn't see it that way. He saw that this right here, this is my chance. When I'm being pressured, when I'm being questioned, this is my opportunity so that there would be more Christ released. And again, we're barely touching this. Wait till we get over here just a little further, even in the first chapter, you'll see that this thing goes to the very core of the way Paul views things. And yet, everything that I'm saying still is not where we're going in the big revelation that God wants to reveal in chapter 2. It's still not the fullness of that in the way that the Lord wants to bring it out. All right, again, running out of time, so let's read verse 8. For God is my witness. The word for, you know, when you read that and a sentence starts with for, you have to ask, what's it there for? Okay? It's there because it's referring back to, even as it is right for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, ye all are partakers of my grace. For God is my witness how greatly I long after you all in the bowels of Jesus Christ, or the tender mercies of Jesus Christ. So here we have the true explanation, the true definitions of what was being said in verse 7. And what was being said there is that Paul says, it is right for me to think this of you all because I have you in my heart. It is right for my view of you to be this way because I have you in my heart. But then in my heart begins to be defined as the bowels of Jesus Christ inside of me, or the tender mercies of Christ who lives in me. And he is painting now a relationship outside of, remember, verses 2 through 6. Always God somewhere else doing something. And they're all relating to him based on something that he would do. In this case, his God is on the inside of him. And his God is working from the inside out, not the outside in. And folks, that's just an everyday principle that'll help you. God always works from the inside out, and the devil always works from the outside in. It's just the way that it works. Our comprehension of the Lord may start outside, though, as we begin to know him, but you will end up within. Okay, and the example I'm thinking about that is when God made the tabernacle, or when he presented it to Moses. When he presented it, he starts with the Ark of the Covenant. He starts with the Holy of Holies. He starts within there. Then he goes to the holy place. And then he goes to the altar is. And then he goes to the outer court. And then he goes to the gates. And then, you know. So when he started from the inside. However, as the people progressed in that, a priest, he would start through the gate, then he'd go past the altar and da-da-da-da until he ended up on the inside. But when God starts it, he starts with his son. He starts right there with Christ, the real thing, not an altar that is a shadow of the cross, not a laver that is a shadow of the word, not a altar of incense that is a picture of Christ in the church and of the Holy Spirit bringing forth the light. It's, you know, it was just called a candlestick, but it was hollow and it was filled with oil, and the oil was lit, and that lighting was Christ in the seven churches that represents seven being in completion. I'm going through a bunch of stuff right now, but all that being a shadow, so it doesn't matter. Table of showbread, shadow. But when you went in the Holy of Holies, sitting on that mercy seat, that was God. That's the real thing. That's not a shadow. Everything was pointing to something of reality until you got in there And then you met reality face to face. And by, and if the altar was an explanation of the Lamb, then you would not know him by looking at the altar. You would know the shadow of him. You only know him by looking at him, and that explains the shadow, and then you go, oh, okay. But everybody's trying to explain Christ in the shadow. That's just crazy. I mean, doesn't it? I mean, if you had a big light up here and you could see my hand, would it make any sense to go up and say, okay, you know, you see this shadow finger there? Not looking at the hand, looking at the shadow of the finger. You see that? Well, that's Christ. Well, no, that's not Christ. It's a shadow of Christ in a certain way. To explain the shadows is not the answer. We must see Jesus, and then we understand, oh, but we see in a glass darkly until we see face to face. That's what it says in 1 Corinthians 13. And so there is this seeing that Paul is trying to bring them to. They're not even close yet. And in the verses we're at, we're not close. I don't care what we've said. We have not stepped beyond the veil yet. We have not stepped beyond the veil. We're still, Paul is bringing them along as much as he can at this stage. Okay, so he begins to explain, "For God is my witness." God is my witness. God knows. Okay, but wait a minute. What is he talking about? Another external relationship? God is my witness how greatly I long after you in the bowels of Jesus Christ. What is God witnessing? God is witnessing that there is an internal reality of Christ that is at work causing Paul to have tender affections and concern for the well-being of other people, and Paul calls it Christ in him. And he says, God is my witness to this. God knows that this is Christ. God knows his son, and can I say it? God knows a fake. Why? Well, we haven't gotten, you know, we've only mentioned it. But the coin, we mentioned it, the coin is going to play a huge part in this. God's coin and the explanation of this two-sided coin. We're not there yet, but all we say at this stage is there is a certain currency in which God trades, and he will not deal with counterfeits. He will only deal in a certain coinage. He'll only deal in a certain currency. He'll only deal in a certain manner. And everything outside of that, he calls counterfeit. And you have Paul saying that in a couple of places, like, what is it, 2 Corinthians, within the last 10 verses there, he talks about this counterfeit deal. In fact, the word counterfeit isn't there. It's in the Greek. You have to sort of look around a little bit. All right. So I'll just read a little bit because I just keep talking here. Verse 8 is a testament to this view and to Paul's methodology. To what view? To this view that Paul, in the verse right in front and in the words just prior to these words in verse 8, said, in my bonds and in my defense, not of me but the gospel, you have become partakers of my grace, and this, and him saying, for God is my witness how greatly I long after you are. How greatly does Paul long after them? To what degree? To the degree that he'll go into death, to the degree that he'll go into prison, to the degree that he'll go into loss, this is what at work in him? A concept? A principle? No, no, and no, no. A teaching? A book that somebody wrote? A book that R.T. Nussbaum wrote? No, that will not show you the truth. Only, Paul says, only do I have this by the work of Christ in me. And that explains my willingness to suffer. That explains. I know you can't see it all here, but he's not saying, I'm not into suffering. He's saying, basically, but he's trying to explain, I'm not into suffering. I don't particularly like suffering. I'm not going for suffering, except in light of the truth of God himself, who's at work in me, who is willing to do all this stuff. And he says, God is my witness, it ain't me. Yeah. And, you know, I would say, you'd be a fool to go this way without seeing Christ. You'd be a fool to go there. You know, there are a lot of preachers with a lot of different messages, and a lot of them sound good. And folks, I understand that. I am not a man that is opposed to you going out and joining the prosperity movement in that sense, if that's where you're at. But some people along the way are going to see Jesus. And when they see Jesus, it's going to cause a break with their mind, which is the mind of the world. It will be a taking on of another mind. Oh, wait a minute. We're jumping to Philippians 2. Can't do that yet. Hold our reins. But it is. And it's a break with, let me say it like this. It's a break with sanity. To break with sanity. Because sanity would tell you, save yourself. You know, the thing that tickles me, a lot of the movies that come out, if you really watch them, the ones that people go to see a lot, you know, that a bunch of people attend, they are movies that somewhere along the line, the hero actually is willing to give up their own life for someone that doesn't deserve it. Did you know that? If you wrote down that template and every time you went to a movie, you honestly would be shocked at how many times, you know, the last Spider-Man to the last Batman. Folks, come on. If you go right down the line, look at it. Look what happened. Look at the storyline instead of just going, for some reason I just like this, you know. There is something calling out in you that says, that's the right way to go. The problem with that, there's more of it going on in the movies than in anybody's life. That's the problem. But we'll sit there in movie after movie and go, oh, how can you believe it? No, I can't. You know, the guy got rich off of this. You know, the actor that did, he didn't really give up anything. He made a fortune at your expense. But Jesus didn't make a fortune at our expense. Jesus is a real story and a real reality. And Jesus is still the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he's still selfless in his view. But again, I just keep having to say this. This doesn't explain the pattern, nor does it explain the coin that God wants us to bring out here when we get to chapter 2. All right. So verse 8 is a testament to this view and Paul's methodology of life out of death. Here he speaks of his great interior love that motivates his self-giving for them and describes that inner impetus as the bowels of Jesus Christ. He declares to them that this great affection and self-giving love that works within him is based on Christ living on the inside of him, who is manifesting his affections through Paul and is not based on his own tenderness. I originally wrote resources and I thought, it's true, but we need to say tenderness because why? Because, all right. if you are naturally a sweet person, and you also are a natural giver, you like to give. And there are some people, they just like giving stuff, you know. It's not necessarily Christ. I know people who aren't born again who just like giving, you know. Jesus said it's better to give than receive, you know. To me, it's better to have gifts than receipts. But anyway, that's another story. But they like giving, and they're just sweet about it and everything. Some of those people could really latch on to this, and it'd be nothing more than them. But I want to make it clear that God wants Christ. He doesn't just want certain attributes. Now, there are certain attributes. There's a pattern. I'll show it to you, and I think that it might amaze you. But the pattern itself is not it. Christ is it. Only Christ flows that way, and Paul knows it. And when he says, you have become partakers of my grace, well, be it known that this all is this affection and this willingness that what I went into for your sake was nothing more than Jesus and his tender mercies on the inside of me coming out towards you. Or he said it another way in Galatians 2:20, not I, but Christ. Yes.
This might be just me, but you know, it says it's Christ in you, the hope of glory, and the tender mercies, it talks about the bowels. And so you know that it's in you, because if it was in your stomach, you could throw it up, but if it's in your bowels, it's in you. You've already digested it, so it's in you. It's what's in you. It's not you getting better or anything. It's the hope that's inside of you, that seed that was planted at the first time. I believe that. That's why it talks about tender mercies being about. It's in you.
That's right. And it's Christ in you, but it is, folks, come on. It's more than the doctrine of Christ in you. It is Christ showing up in certain ways. But right now, because we haven't got to the specifics, I have to just be careful, okay? So I have to walk a tightrope and say, but it's not, and it is not, and it will never be certain traits. It must be Christ. But Christ will produce what is Christ, the fruit of Christ, you see? And let me just go a little more on this other thing. Someone who basically has a critical outlook of life, they're not an optimist, they're a pessimist, and they generally don't get along with other people, could go, well, I hate this church. You know, I hate this Bible school. I want out, right? Would that make sense? Because it's calling for selflessness. And you go, I hate that. Okay? So, the one who's nice and sweet assumes that they have more Jesus than, you know, Sister Yucky. Or Brother Yucky, as may be the case. All of those assumptions are wrong. Both sides are wrong. You know? We say, well, so-and-so is so amiable. They're just pleasant to be around. Is it Christ? The Father knows. He does not deal in that kind of currency if it's not Christ. He doesn't trade in it. He's not fooled by it. He doesn't take a bill out and, you know, look under the line and go, I don't know, man, this might be Jesus, but it may not be. He knows. He is clear, crystal clear cut on what is Christ and what's just people, you know, nice people or people trying to act better. Acting better will do you no good. You say, well, it'll make the world happier. Well, I don't, you know, is that really the goal? Nothing of Jesus, no increase of Christ. Let's all just be happier. Are you following what I'm saying? I mean, I say both of you need to pursue the Lord with all your heart. Both of you are equal. That the one factor that should drive both hearts is, I want Jesus. And I will tell you this, if you go long enough, God will show up all your sweetness. He said, don't add honey to this offering. Don't add natural sweeteners to this offering. He said that. Don't add it. I don't want your sweetness mixed in with this, you know. And what's funny is, he didn't say, I don't want your bitterness. He actually said for Passover, bitter herbs, you know. But that had to be Christ. You see what I mean? We say, well, see, he said bitter herbs, and I'm bitter. So this is the Lord. But is my point getting across? That you can go either way and try to justify it, but the end result is, you know, for God is my witness, he said. He didn't say, well, you guys really think I'm special, or you think it's really the Lord, or you think I'm for the Lord. You really think I'm a man of God because I went into prison so that this church would spring up. You know, he didn't say that. He said, God knows. God is my witness. That's all that matters. Yes.
And because God was his witness, he knew God would raise him up. He didn't need some woman calling him a preacher of the Most High or people. He knew God would raise him up because God was his witness.
That's a really good point, because God doesn't raise up what's not Christ going into death. And we'll go into death and we'll suffer loss, and then we'll get mad because nothing ever resulted in it. Do you know what I'm saying? Well, I've been going into death. Well, clearly you have. You know? Yes.
Yeah, I was just saying, I know this guy that he takes care of sick people, like he'll stay in the hospital with them, and I mean, just from all outward appearances, he just pours his life out for others. But if you get to talking to him, you find out his motivation is because he hates Christians, and most Christians don't do that kind of stuff. So it's like he's showing himself as a contrast to Christian, and it's weird.
Time's really gotten away, so let me just read this one last statement. That selfish approach to life for the needs of others is seen in Philippians 1, 20 through 26 as a desire for their gain to his own loss. Paul's way of relating is not primarily to an external Jesus, but to one who pours out of him as living water. All right. And that'll be our final thought in that. Verse 2 through 6 was all an external relationship with God, and Paul never refuted it. Do you understand that? He never refuted. He didn't say there's a problem with that. He didn't say there's a problem with praying. He didn't say there's a problem with thanking God or believing God for doing this or whatever. He didn't go into any of that. He said, I want to introduce something that is in the heart of God and may not yet be in your heart. And he said, and he starts by showing the Lord. Is that 1 minute left? Good grief. He starts by showing the Lord as demonstrated by his life. In his life, as his life. And it's an internal Jesus that he is showing, this is the relationship. This is how you walk. This is the Jesus you need to have more of a relating to than the one of verse 2 through 6. All right, let's close. Father, thank you for these classes, and yet, Lord, we just realize so much that it's sort of tough going through this first chapter, because everything is being said, but the full picture is not given to us until chapter 2. And so we ask you humbly to keep us on task, to keep the compass pointing towards Christ, to keep pressing, even in this class, pressing, saying, I want to know, I want to hear, not from Randy, but from the Holy Spirit, this thing that stirs us and excites us and yet troubles us all at the same time. I want to know for myself. Father, may you answer those heart prayers. May all of us, including me, grow ever more into a decrease and into an increase, so that Christ may eventually be all and in all. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.